Manifest Destiny. The belief that American settlers were destined to expand across North America was an integral part of American culture in the 19th century. The destiny was vague. Some viewed it as a mission to extend Republican democracy to peoples across the continent, while others viewed it as God's wish to civilize the people of American institutions, spreading them across the New World. Various treatises were created to further this idea, buying the Louisiana Territory from France and Florida from Spain, as well as fixing boundaries to extend American influence from sea to shining sea. In this episode, we will be looking at one more potential target for this belief system, the Yucatan Peninsula. The Yucatan had appealed to the United States for annexation, as they desperately needed military assistance against a local Mayan uprising. When this was brought to the United States government, President James K. Polk mildly approved of the offer, and it passed the House of Representatives, but was blocked by the Senate, citing the war in Mexico as their primary concern. But for the sake of alternate history, let's look at what would happen if the United States annexed the Yucatan Republic. But first, we need some history. The Yucatan was twice a republic during the 19th century, the first in 1823, where it joined the Mexican Federation following independence. Mexico had gained independence from Spain in 1821 as the first Mexican Empire. This empire, led by Emperor Augustine I, quickly had massive stability issues. In August of the following year, a plan to overthrow Augustine was discovered, which encompassed 16 members of Congress. In late October of the same year, Augustine had dissolved Congress, as they were heavily criticizing him and his policies. This led to revolts all across the empire, and him eventually being deposed. This also led to the formation of the Central American Republic, which encompassed all lands between Mexico and Panama, which had been unofficial provinces in the empire. From there, Mexico was formed as a republic, with the new constitutions put in place in 1824. This constitution was repealed in 1835, putting in an era of a centralist government. This centralist government caused a massive amount of rebellion and republic declarations within the following years. A rebellion started in the states of Zacatecas and Tabasco, which, combined with the successful Texan Revolution in 1835, heavily weakened the government's control in the outer regions of the country. When the French invaded Mexico in 1838, this only further weakened the centralist control over the country, sparking more rebellions in the Rio Grande and another rebellion in Tabasco. The Yucatan declared their independence again in 1841, citing the stripping away of local autonomy as the main cause. The original centralist government had accepted the Yucatan independence in some capacity, but when sent to Anastasia's coup in 1841, he radicalized the centralist government and sent an army to retake the territory. They managed to fight back against the Mexican army, but were facing severe economic issues due to the blocking of Mexican trade and later blocking by the United States government, and a war against the local Mayan. In desperation, the Yucatan government pleaded with various governments for military assistance in exchange for sovereignty. But in this alternate scenario, what if the United States Senate passed the resolution to annex the Yucatan? For this scenario to work within reality, a few things would need to be changed. First, President Polk dies in 1846, shortly after the war with Mexico starts, and Vice President George M. Dallas takes power. This isn't that hard to see happening, as Polk's health was rather poor at the time, and he had a habit of overworking himself. Once he left office at the end of a term, he died 1 month after. Dallas was much more of an expansionist on an opportunist in nature. So long as the Mexican-American War is going on, he will likely claim that annexing the Yucatan is a vital goal in defeating Mexico. And second, the US government would have to be partially blind in its understanding of the Mayan conflict. The Mayan were far more numerous than any of the native tribes that the United States had dealt with previously, and they were masters at juggling such guerrilla warfare. Once the Yucatan got some Mexican weaponry and small contingents of troops, they managed to push back the Mayan from the major settlements, but they still had large control over the territory. This would be a constant and bloody conflict that would last for decades in the territory. In our timeline, it wasn't until 1933 that the last Mayan uprising occurred, nearly 100 years from its start. Now, we know this in hindsight, but it is easily possible to imagine the US government seeing them as an easy enemy and not taking the conflict as seriously as it should have been. So in this scenario, the USA stumbles into the Yucatan sometime in late 1847 and early 1848, and the supply of guns and a few troops allows the local Yucatans to do similar to what they did in our timeline and recapture significant parts of the peninsula, though the Mayans still control large swaths of territory. That's enough for the US to convince themselves for a while that the Yucatan is easily winnable. With that, come the 1850 Missouri Compromise, the Yucatan would be allocated as a slave state, which would still have the support of the local population to some degree. One of the large problems in their war against the Mayan was that they wanted to use them as a labor force to farm the cash crops of sugar and henequen. It would be unlikely that the Yucatan would be admitted as a state in whole. More than likely, it would either be kept as a popular sovereignty territory or admitted the whole region as a state, even if the control is only nominal. It's possible for this as well, since the lands to the west of Texas and even large parts of Texas itself aren't very suitable for slavery crop production. Regions of the northern Mexican states, or possibly Baja California as a whole, will likely be annexed in this scenario as well, as a different negotiator would be able to secure more land from the desperate Mexican government, and Santa Anna's government was willing to cede the underpopulated land. But what does this mean for the future? Well, the underlying political causes of the American Civil War would only be amplified in this scenario, as the drive for slave or free state balance in the government would come to a head, and the cause of occupying and protecting these new territories, all of which had significant native populations and a large number of Catholic Mexicans, would prove a major splitting point between the public. It would be an unnecessary war to wage in the Yucatan in the eyes of many, and support back home for these sorts of adventures likely wouldn't hold for very long. By the time of the American Civil War, the position in the Yucatan would be interesting to say the least. The territory would largely be sympathetic to the Southern cause, as the Southern population already had a style of serfdom before the annexation, and the military presence would likely be of Southern origin if manned by a volunteer army. But the main concern for the Yucatan would be of protection. The Mayan would still be a pressing issue to the populace, as it would be impossible to fully pacify them just due to disease, terrain, and the skill of the Mayan people. Regardless of which side the Yucatan goes with, if one at all, protection for the region would be severely limited, and that weakness could very well be exploited as the military focuses back at home. But by the time of the Civil War, local authorities within the newly conquered Mexican territory would likely attempt to build up a case for reunification with Mexico. Sympathies wouldn't lie with the Union or Confederates more than likely, as the local population would be considered largely second-class citizens within the United States, with many cultural and religious differences between the two. Mexico could possibly fund separatist groups within its former land, and possibly even wage war to take back the land, but beyond that, it's hard to say. I hope you like this brief scenario about what would happen if the United States annexed the Yucatan Republic. If you'd like to learn a little bit more, if you'd like to hear another scenario about the United States annexing the whole of Mexico, click here for the episode that I did about that. Don't forget to like and subscribe, and I'll catch you guys next time.